soto de boska sati de bosko soto de boska sata da boska sati libro shite de bosko zoto de boska zaki de bosko zoto de boska sati libro shakali de bosko zoto de boska zata da da boska sati libro shika da da baska zate de boska sati de boska sata. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love. We thank you for your kindness. We thank you for your compassion. We thank you for giving us your word. We thank you that your word is building us up. We thank you for your Holy Spirit that lives in us. We thank you that our hearts and minds are opened, ready to hear the word, ready to welcome the word, ready to understand the word, ready to do the word without delay, knowing fully well that you are more interested in our success than we could ever be. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Greetings to you. Welcome to all of you to our Sunday service, online service. It's good to have you joining us. And I would encourage you at this time that you get your relatives, your friends, and your enemies who might not be connected for the service to connect to the service right now. They'll be mightily blessed. And I also encourage you to have the seriousness that you are actually in service, even though you might be watching the service on your own or just your family or with friends or a few other people. You are in service. God is watching you, and God has got this service with you in mind. Today I'm teaching you part 3 in this series, Focus on the Word. Focus on the Word. Just to follow from last week's Sunday, we started showing that there are two dimensions of the Word. There is focus on the Word from the first dimension I shared with you last week, Sunday, that the Word of God is Logos. That is the Greek word Logos, spelled L-O-G-O-S, all right? So, and it gave you some examples, just very clear, some examples with the parable of the sower, where Jesus made it clear that the Word of God is most important. And we shared many great truths. And the Word of God is what? Logos. So from Genesis to Revelation, that is the written Word of God. That is the Logos Word of God. Very important for you to understand that. And Jesus showed us with the parable of the sower that the most important parable is the parable of the sower. And we taught you in great detail last week, Sunday, because the parable of the sower makes it clear that you need to prioritize the Word. So I would encourage you to watch that service again. That service last week's Sunday's online service is available on our YouTube channel, and it's there under the title Focus on the Word Part 2. Focus on the Word Part 2. Our YouTube channel link is on your screens right now, and I would encourage you to go and watch it as soon as you have an opportunity to do so. And I encourage you to subscribe to the channel for free as well, and share the link with your friends, relatives, and enemies. Encourage them to subscribe too. There are great scriptural resources on that platform. Now, today we're going to share with you the other dimension of the Word of God. But before we do so, I just want to take you to John 17, verse 17 in King James Bible. John 17, verse 17. Let's start off there. John 17, verse 17. It's written, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. So this verse here shows us clearly that God's word is truth. The Greek word translated word in that verse is logos. So it says God's word, God's written word is truth. Very important for you to understand. And I'd encourage you, if you just go to another scripture here. First Timothy. Sorry, let's go to 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. 2 Timothy 3, verse 16. We've just seen that the Word of God, the Logos, the written Word of God, is truth. And that is very important for us. 2 Timothy 3, verse 16. It's written there, every scripture is God-breathed, given by His inspiration, and profitable for instruction, for reproof and conviction of sin, for correction of error and discipline in obedience, and for training in righteousness, in holy living, in conformity to God's will, in thought, purpose, and action. You see, as Christians, we must live with our thinking must conform to God's thinking. Our purpose must conform to God's purpose for us. Just see the verse again. Very important for you to understand. Every Christian, let's go through the scripture again, 2 Timothy verse 16. Every scripture is God breathed. So every scripture, every verse that you have, see, in the Bible from Genesis to Revelation, we have the scriptures, the logos, the written word of God. And we told you, every scripture, every logos, every word of God is God breathed, given by his inspiration, and profitable for instruction. So you see that logos of God is profitable for instruction. So when you go through God's word, you are getting instructions from God. Carry them out. Let's go to reading again. Instruction, for reproof. You know, if you want to prove anything, God's word, let it be your evidence. For conviction of sin. When you go through God's word, see, there are things you might be doing which you might not know that they are sin. God's word will reveal to you that they are sin. So conviction, so that you get to know it in your spirit that this is sin. It says, for correction of error. Just in case you are doing some things that are in error, God's word will correct you. As you get to understand God's word, it's for correction of error and discipline in obedience and for training in righteousness. We'll come back to training righteousness later today. For training righteousness in holy living, in conformity to God's will, in thought, purpose, and action. Very important. So God's word, the Logos, helps you so that you get to what? You get to what? To be able to live or think in line with God. You get to think the way God thinks. See, the Logos, word of God, as you go through it, it gives you the ability to think. It gives you information that helps you to think the way God thinks. It shows you the mentality of God. It also reveals to you the purpose of God. It also reveals to you how to act. Very important. So that's that, the Logos, word of God, very important for you to understand. Now, today we move to another dimension to see the other dimension of the word of God. Let's go to Luke chapter 4 from verse 1 to 4. We're reading to you from the Amplified Bible Classic. Luke chapter 4 from verse 1. And it says, then Jesus, full of and controlled by the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led in by the Holy Spirit. Remember, our title of today is what? Focus on the Word. This is part 3. Let's continue. Verse 2. For during 40 days in the wilderness, desert, where he was tempted, tried, tested exceedingly by the devil, and he ate nothing during those days. And when they were completed, he was hungry. Now, Jesus here, this is the only time where we record in the Bible of Jesus fasting for 40 days and 40 nights. Now, understand here, Jesus never gave an instruction to say you must fast 40 days and 40 nights. Fast as much as the Holy Spirit directs you to fast. So Jesus here fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. And that's how the Holy Spirit led him to do. So if you are led to go that way as well, no problem. Go for it. But don't prescribe it for everybody. You need to understand that the Holy Spirit will speak to you and guide you to fast for as long as he guides you. Now, understand that fasting does not put pressure on God. Some people think that when they pray and fast, they are pressurizing God to act. You can think you pressurize God who created the heavens and the earth. You can't. Fasting sharpens your spiritual antennas. Fasting helps you to pick up signals of the Holy Spirit. Fasting helps you to hear from the Holy Spirit with clarity. It helps you to hear from God with clarity. You see, so that's why it's so important. Don't fast only when your pastor tells them their church is fasting. Fast is good for you. Don't just fast. Pray and fast. Meditate on God's word in your days of fasting. It's very important so that you can hear more from God, so that you can fellowship more with the Holy Spirit. So understand that fasting raises up your spiritual antennas so you can pick up signals of the spirit with clarity. We'll teach that some other day soon. We've taught it so many times, but there'll be special teaching coming on that soon. Now, let's go back to Luke 4, verse 3. That's what I mean. Then the devil said to him, notice here, Jesus has fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and the devil is not intimidated by Jesus praying and fasting. The devil said to him, if you are the Son of God, order this stone to turn into a loaf of bread. Very important. If you are the Son of God, order this stone to turn into a loaf of bread. Because Jesus is hungry. So physically, he needs food. All right? He needs food. Let's see Jesus' response. Luke 4, verse 4. And Jesus replied to him, it is written, man shall not live and be sustained by bread alone. But what? But by every word and expression of God. Notice Jesus says, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word and expression of God. We just pause that verse for a moment. We need to understand that the real you is a spirit that has a soul and lives in a body. I repeat, the real you, as you're hearing me right now, as you're watching right now, you are a spirit that has a soul and lives in a body. You see, now, in your soul, that's where you have your feelings, that's where you have your emotions, that's where you have your reasoning, your mentality, your mindset, your thought process, whatever word you want to use. In your soul, that is where you make decisions, and you make decisions in your soul on the basis of the information that you have or don't have. Or are lacking. See, if you have the wrong information, you make wrong decisions. If you have the right information, you make right decisions. So that's very important for you. You make decisions in your soul. So the information you get conditions your soul, gets you into a certain way of reasoning. You understand? As I'm preaching and teaching to you right now, I'm giving you information. As information comes through, it changes your thinking. So even in your soul now, you make decisions differently. Very, very important. So your body is the physical body. You need your physical body to exist in this world, in this earth. You need your physical body. So the physical body is the house, the container for the real you. That is what the inner man, the real you, is a spirit that is a soul. Now, your spirit and your soul are what are commonly referred to in some terms as the inner man. So the inner man refers to your spirit and your soul. When you get born again, it is your spirit that is born again. It is your spirit that is brand new. But your soul is the same soul as before, and your body is the same body as before. But as you hear God's word, your thinking is changed. You see? Your soul is changed. You get information. You make different decisions. The Holy Spirit comes to live inside of you, throughout all of you. So you've got to understand that. So that's why one is you need God's word so much. We teach it in greater depth in one of the upcoming services. But with that basis, let's go back to Luke chapter 4, verse 4. Let's read it again on Amplified so you can get clarity. And Jesus replied to him, it is written, man shall not live and be sustained by bread alone, but by every word and expression of God. So what Jesus is showing us, he says, hang on, there's two types of sustenance needed. For man to live, you need to eat food. Jesus was fasting, he needed to eat food, he was hungry. So Jesus says, you don't feed on bread alone. The food you eat nourishes your physical body. The food you eat gives nutrients that are needed by your physical body. Very important. You need to eat food. Now, Jesus makes it clear, says, hang on. You don't live on bread alone. You live as well on every word and expression of God. Every word of God. See, your spirit, the real you, needs spiritual food. The spiritual food for your spirit is the word of God. Is the word of God. Now, in that verse, Luke 4, verse 4, the Greek word translated word in Luke 4 verse 4 is rhema, R-H-E-M-A, rhema. It is not logos. So you need to get that. So let's go back now with this understanding now that the word just talk about there. He's talking about the rhema. Okay, he says, and just but it is written, men shall not live and be sustained by bread alone, but by every rhema and expression of God. Now, also the word translated man in Luke chapter 4, verse 4, hallelujah, is not man as in male. Okay, it is the Greek word anthropos. I'll spell it for you. A-N-T-H-R-O-P-O-S. Anthropos. A-N-H-R-O-P-O-S. Anthropos. And anthropos refers to human beings, both male and female. So it refers to human beings, both male and female. That is very important for you to understand. So if you go to that verse again, let's go to Luke 4, verse 4 again. Jesus is talking. He says, hang on. And Jesus replied to him, it is written, man shall not live and be sustained by bread alone, but by every word, the expression of God. Man, male and female, boys and girls, ladies and gentlemen, shall not live on bread alone, but they shall live on the word, the rhema, expression of God, the rhema word of God. Very important. You eat food a lot. Now notice Jesus in that verse, he makes it clear, he says, it is written. So it's clear to you that Jesus had a reading culture. Jesus had a reading culture. Very, very important. Hallelujah. He had a reading culture. Brothers and sisters, we need to have a reading culture. It's good for you to read the Bible. That's excellent. You should read the Bible every day and good Christian materials. But you also need to read other materials that will build you up, that will help you to go forward. I would encourage, you know, I always told you, those of you that have been with me long enough, I said, make up your point. Try and read at least one book apart from the Bible every month. Very important. We need to develop a reading culture. We need to inculcate in our children a reading culture. Focus on the word of God. We will need you to read the word of God, the logos of God. So you see in Luke 4, verse 4, Jesus says, it is written. What is he doing? He is referring to the scriptures. He's saying, it is written. He knows the logos for himself. See, as I told us, if the logos remains in the Bible, in Genesis to Revelation, it's of no use. It needs to be in your heart. You need to feed your spirit. So Jesus is talking there. He's not opening the scriptures at that point. It is in him. Remember, we showed you in the last few weeks how Jesus used to go to the place of worship in Jerusalem with his parents, Joseph and Mary. How he used to go and had a hunger to learn. We showed you the past few weeks in the messages called Be Prepared. So you've got to understand there very clearly. So what Jesus is talking, see, that is the word of the Lord, the logos of God, which is now in his spirit. In other words, it has been taken from the scriptures, the written scriptures. It's now in the spirit. So Jesus said, hang on, you will not be able to live. You don't live on bread alone. You don't eat on bread alone, chicken alone, cake, whatever it is. But on every word, from what? Every rhema. Every rhema is a vision of God. And says, where is it? It is written. So the moment the word is no longer in the scriptures, it's now in your spirit, you are making progress. The rhema word, the expression of God. Now, let's just go and get you clarity on the definition of rhema. Hallelujah. If we say a word is rhema, a rhema word is spoken. A rhema word is spoken. It is a spoken word. It is spoken. I just read some definitions that I wrote down here. Rhema word is spoken to quicken. It is spoken to quicken. It is a specific word of the Spirit. It is spoken to quicken. It is a specific word of the Spirit. You see, when you're born again, the Holy Spirit lives in you. As I'm preaching and teaching to you, as you get understanding, that word will be in your spirit. It cannot be stolen by the devil from you because you have understanding of it. In times of trouble, it is the word of God that is inside you that you speak out. You see, that logos you heard, you understood it. When you understood it, it became imbibed in your spirit. It became part of your spirit. When the challenges come, you then speak it. It becomes what? Rhema. It's a spoken word. It's a quickening word. It's a speeding word. You got to understand that. Very, very important. So Jesus is confronted by the devil. There's a temptation there. The devil tried to tempt Jesus to follow his instructions. The devil wants Jesus to follow his instructions. Jesus responds to the devil, to the temptation, with what? With the spoken word. It says, it is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word from the mouth of God. He's countering the devil with the word from where? From his spirit. Hallelujah. The word that is inside. So when you speak the word now, the rhema word becomes the now word. You can't say when you're in trouble, let me look for the Bible now. Let me look for the Bible now. Let me look for the verse. You won't find. Hallelujah. You understand that? Focus on the word so that what you're taking in will bring growth. When you eat bread, if a baby's child is growing, if a child is growing, you feed the child with food. That food which the child eats is what makes the child grow. That food which the child has taken inside, has eaten, will be digested and then converted into building blocks needed to make the muscles grow, needed to make the bones grow, needed to make the child grow. Now, in the spiritual dimension, the word of God makes you grow spiritually. The word of God I'm teaching to you makes you grow spiritually. It makes you tough. It makes you strong. Hallelujah. And the more you grow, the more, if a baby starts by drinking milk only, as the baby grows, you get to a point whereby you can now eat meat. You cannot, until the baby cannot eat hard stuff. In the spiritual things, we start by feeding you with milk. But as you grow in the Lord, you end up eating hard stuff, stronger stuff. God has graced us in this ministry with some deep revelations of God's word. Because God, by his own grace, his own favor, has found that we are ready to have that. Hallelujah. You see, ministries are different. You can find many ministries with many millions, if not billions of members, but they are spiritual babies. Fed on milk. You got to understand that you know, every church must grow. Everyone must grow. And even we are growing. Hallelujah. It's a ministry. Thank God. But understand that the word of God in a time of trouble is the, you must speak the rhema. The word of God that is inside you. That's why it's important. The word of God you get in good times is preparing for the times ahead. The word of God you get in the tough times is praying for the times still to come. So that's why you must always, God in his favor always revealed to you his word so that you stay ahead of whatever challenge or obstacle you face. The rhema word, the spoken word. You see, let's give you an example. In chemistry, they've got what they call catalysts. Okay, I'll just read for you a definition of a catalyst. A catalyst is a substance that increases the rate of a chemical reaction without itself undergoing any permanent chemical change. A catalyst is a substance that increases the rate of a chemical reaction without itself undergoing any permanent chemical change. Very important. Hallelujah. So, that's a catalyst. It speeds up a chemical reaction. Now, without itself going through any change, the word of God, the rhema, hallelujah, of God, the word of God, the spoken word, quickens things, makes things happen. Makes a way of escape for you out of challenges quicker. Makes results manifest in your life quicker. You see? The Bible is very clear. One of my all-time favorite scriptures, you now know it off by heart. Romans 18, verse 21. I read for you the King James Bible version. The power of life and death is in the tongue, and they that love it shall eat of it. Romans 18, verse 21. So if you have lots of God's word in you, no matter what challenge you face, you speak rhema, the now word. The specific word that will quicken, that will produce results faster. The word spoken, the rhema word, the now word for you. The Holy Spirit inside you will help you to speak the now word. As I'm preaching to you, I'm also giving you rhema, the word that God wants you to have now. It comes alive to you now. So there's the word. Someone say, I'm not facing, what Pastor Andrew was preaching, I'm not facing challenges around that area. God is preparing you for the times ahead. See, some people are so proud or suffer from spiritual ignorance. Say, no, the word that is not for me because I'm not going through those problems. It is preparing you for the times ahead. Just said, you live in the times ahead through the word of God. It's preparing you. The food you eat immediately won't make you grow immediately this 1 second. It has to be digested. Hallelujah. And produce growth. So you see, the rhema word is very important. So as we read the written word, hallelujah, as we read the written word, the logos of God, as we understand it, it goes into our spirits. And now, when we speak the rhema word, the now word that is needed altogether, right, it comes the rhema word. Let's go to see a good example of the importance of the rhema word. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 6, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. To help show you the importance of the rhema word. Now, before I go into Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10, you know, we talk about Jesus made it clear Luke 4, verse 4, that men shall not live on bread alone, but every word that comes from the mouth of God. The rhema comes from the mouth of God. You see, today is Father's Day. And we have an interesting challenge right now. Is that a lot of men do not go to church anymore. They believe that church is for the wife and the children. So they don't get to be taught God's word. So in their spirits, they have a spiritual deficiency. They have a word deficiency. They have spiritual kwashioka. Right? They don't even mention God's word. And when times of trouble come, they will respond in ways that are contrary to the word of God. I want to give you some statistics that will help you understand that. You must pray for all men, hallelujah, to hunger and thirst for God's word. If you are married, pray that your husband will hunger and thirst for God's word. Now, I'll give you some few statistics that will just help you and show you the deficiency that is taking place in terms of feeding on God's word. In many churches, the majority of people members are women by a long shot. You know, and so I'm thankful we have a lot of men that hunger for and thirst for the word of God in OSK Assembly. And we pray that more and more men who hunger and thirst for the word of God. Hallelujah. These are the statistics on the prison population. I'll start off with the United Kingdom. In the year 2019, the United Kingdom had almost 78,000, okay, male prisoners and only 3,800 female prisoners. Do you hear that? So if you look at the ratios, it's almost like 1 to 20. For every female prisoner, there are 20 male prisoners. In the United States of America, in the year 2017, 90.6% of prisoners were males. 9.4% were female. Giving you a ratio of, for every one female prisoner, there were 10 male prisoners. In South Africa, in March 2019, South Africa had 97.4% male prisoners and 2.6% female prisoners, giving you a ratio of about 1 to 32. Zimbabwe, in March 2020, had 97.6% male prisoners and 2.6% female prisoners. Giving you roughly more or less the same percentage as South Africa, that for every female prisoner, there are 32 male prisoners. What does it tell you? Well, one thing you see, if you look at how many women go to church and feed on God's word in South Africa and Zimbabwe, they are a way bigger number than the men. And if you look at the prison population, it is showing. In the United States of America and in England and many parts of the so-called developed world, a lot of the men no longer go to church. And a lot of the women in increasing numbers no longer feed on God's word. They no longer go to church. And you can see their percentages of the prison population are also increasing. So what does it tell us? We need to pray for men, for fathers, men, males, fathers, to hunger and thirst for the word of God so that they don't end up in doing nefarious activities. The answer is for them to grow in feeding on God's word. Hallelujah. Now, let us go now to Ephesians chapter 16. Ephesians chapter 6 from verse 10. Ephesians chapter 6 from verse 10. Apostle Paul, the number one disciple of Jesus Christ, is writing to the Christians at Ephesus, and is the number of Jesus Christ in the New Testament, and is giving them some tips. Let's see here. You see how it puts up together, and you see how important Rhema is. This is a very popular passage of scripture. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. Paul is writing to them. He says, in conclusion, this is his ending part now. This is his last chapter to the Ephesians church. In conclusion, be strong in the Lord. Be empowered through your union with him. Draw your strength from him. That strength which his boundless might provides. He said to them, be strong in the Lord. Let's continue. He tells us more. Next verse, verse 11. It says, put on God's whole armor, the armor of a heavy armed soldier, which God supplies, that you may be able successfully to stand up against all the strategies and the deceits of the devil. Put on all of God's armor, the armor of a heavy armed soldier, which God supplies, that you may be able successfully to stand up against all the strategies and the deceits of the devil. Notice here, Paul says, hang on, it doesn't matter what challenge Satan puts in your path. It doesn't matter what obstacles you face that Satan tries to put in your path. Paul says, you put on all of God's armor, you will be able to face it. Let's go to the next verse. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12. It says, for we are not wrestling with flesh and blood, contending only with physical opponents, but against the despotisms, against the powers, against the master spirits who are the world rulers of this present darkness, against the spirit forces of wickedness in the heavenly supernatural sphere. I'm not preaching too much in that today. We want to get to focus on the word. You see where we're going. Just stay with me. Let's go to verse 13. In 6 verse 13. Paul again says, therefore, you see, when you do mathematics, when you put a therefore sign, remember those three dots? Whichever sign says, therefore, put on God's complete armor. You're about to get to the answer. Remember, he told us only put on full armor. He says again, therefore, put on. Notice he didn't say God will put on the armor for you. He says, put on God's complete armor that you may be able to resist and stand your ground on the evil day of danger. And having done all the crisis demands, to stand firmly in your place. Notice clearly, Ephesians 6 verse 13, Paul makes it clear that there will be an evil day. It doesn't matter how much praying and fasting you do, there will be an evil day. There will be evil days where you face enormous challenges, serious challenges, not because you are in sin, not because you've done anything wrong, but because the enemy has orchestrated things against you. So Paul says, hang on, put on God's complete armor that you may be able to, number one, resist. So that you don't fall into Satan's temptations. Many excellent people fall into Satan's temptations. So Paul says, hang on, put on all of God's armor so that you're able to resist. Bring the verse up again. Hallelujah. So you're able to resist. Not only resist, and stand your ground. You are not a pushover. It doesn't matter what challenge comes. You resist, you stand your ground. We live in times whereby coronavirus and COVID-19 challenges have been putting on so many pressures, Christians, so many people are full of fear. But hang on, there are others, hallelujah, like us, like some of us, who are resisting the devil, hallelujah. We cannot be pushed over. It doesn't matter what he brings, we keep on standing. Stand your ground. Stand your ground. Don't allow Satan to take away your ground. Don't allow Satan to take away your rights in Christ. Don't allow Satan. Stand your ground. Don't allow the government to take your ground away. Don't allow the economy, the politics, your family, or anybody else to take away what is rightfully yours in Christ. Bring it up. Hallelujah. Therefore, put on God's complete armor that you may be able to resist and stand your ground on the evil day of danger. And having done all the crisis demands, to stand firmly in your place. Notice here, it doesn't matter what challenge you are facing. Paul is telling us, hang on, by the grace of God, you will be able to do everything that the crisis demands. Everything that the challenge demands. So put on God's full armor, so you're able to do everything that the crisis, that the challenge demands. He doesn't say, cry as much as you can so that people feel pity for you and then maybe the crisis passes away. No, he says, put on your full armor and be able to resist and be able to stand your ground. Hallelujah. Put up again, Libroshka Satan. Able to stand your ground on the evil day of danger. And having done all that the crisis demands, to stand firmly in your place. In other words, you stand victorious. You stand victorious. You are not defeated by the challenge. You don't quit. You don't give up. You don't give in. You stand. Satan can bring it on. You say, bring it on. He can't defeat you. Hallelujah. You stand. So, how? Let's continue. Verse 14. Then 6, verse 14. Paul says again, stand therefore. Hold your ground. Having tightened the belt of truth. Having tightened what? The belt of truth. We saw earlier from the beginning that John 17:17, God's word is what? Truth. The Logos, the written word of God is what? Truth. So Paul is telling us, Ephesians 6, verse 14, hang on. Having tied the belt of truth around your loins. How do you do that? When you read the Logos, when you heard the word of God, like I'm preaching and teaching to you right now, and you understood it, and it went to your spirit, hallelujah, what happens? That gave you the ability to put on the armor. Watch. You see? Truth. Brothers and sisters, it doesn't matter what you say, hold on to the truth. Hold on to God's word. One of the famous examples of Abraham and Sarah, you know the story. She was almost 90 years old and he was almost 100 years old. They had no children. But God had spoken to Abraham and said, you shall be a father of many nations. He took on God's word. Hallelujah. He took God's word. He acted on it. When his wife Sarah heard the word, she laughed. But Abraham held on to it. And the Bible says he staggered not at faith. Why? He had God's word. When he heard God's word, he understood it. He received it. Great faith came to him. He held on to it. And he acted. He had intimacy with his wife. He was able to be the father of many nations. Let's go back to this. So again, we're building up. So, Ephesians 6 verse 14. Stand therefore, hold your ground. Having tightened the belt of truth around your loins and having put on the breastplate of integrity and of moral rectitude and right standing with God. Give us this verse, Ephesians 6 verse 14 in the King James Bible. Ephesians 6 verse 14 says, stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth and having on the breastplate of righteousness. Truth. Stand therefore, having put on what? About you what? With truth and having on the breastplate of righteousness. Hallelujah. Give us 2 Timothy 3, verse 16 again. Righteousness. 2 Timothy 3, verse 16. The Amplified Bible. 2 Timothy 3, verse 16. The Amplified Bible. Every scripture is God-breathed, given by his inspiration and profitable for instruction, for reproof and conviction of sin, for correction of error and discipline in obedience, and for what? For training in what? In righteousness. In holy living, in conformity to God's will, in thought, purpose, and action. Training in righteousness. When the fathers, when the men are not going to church, when they're not studying God's word, they're not being trained in righteousness. They're ignorant of righteousness. Let's go to Romans 5, verse 17. Before give us Hebrews 5, verse 13 from the King James Bible. Hebrews 5, verse 13 from the King James Bible. Hebrews 5, verse 13. For Apostle Paul is reading, he says again, for everyone that useth milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. So when he says everyone uses milk, it's referring to baby Christians. He says, hang on, if you are unskillful in the word of righteousness, hallelujah. just show you something there. Right, Hebrews 5 verse 13. For everyone that uses milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. Everyone who uses milk who is a baby Christian is carnal, is unskillful in the word of righteousness. Which word there? In the word, you were translated word in Hebrews 5 verse 13 is logos. So, if you have not studied the scriptures on righteousness and understood them, you are a baby Christian. What is righteousness? I don't have time to teach you in the sermon today, but soon, hopefully next week Sunday, we'll be able to make the platform available where you can do the Christian Development Program online. That it teaches, among many other things, it teaches you righteousness. Because if you don't understand righteousness like I'm teaching you right now, it means you are a baby Christian. That's what the scripture means. It doesn't matter how old you are, how long you've been a Christian. If you do not understand righteousness, you are a baby Christian, and you need to know what righteousness is. You need to hear the word of God, understand the Lord's word of God, right? So that is about righteousness, so it's in your spirit. Why must you understand righteousness? Romans 5, verse 17. Let's read it in the King James Bible. Romans 5, verse 17 in the King James Bible. Romans 5, verse 17. For if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one Jesus Christ. You see, if you got born again, what did you receive? Abundance of grace and what? Of the gift of righteousness. So you do what? You reign in life. So if you don't understand what righteousness is, you won't be able to reign over all of life's circumstances. You already, the day you got born again, the gift of righteousness was already imparted to you. I don't have time to share about it in this service earlier. Enroll for a Christian Development Program. You learn more about it. Because hang on, if you don't know what you have, you'll be looking for something that you already have but don't know how to use it. You'll suffer. You can't look for that which you already have and expect to find it if you don't know you have it. You see? So fathers, we want to pray for fathers, we want to pray for men to hunger and thirst for God's word so they can learn what about righteousness. Let's go back now to Ephesians chapter 6. I think the last verse where I think it was 13. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 6. I think it was 13. Get ready to close now. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 13. Therefore, put on God's complete armor that you may be able to resist and stand your ground on evil day of danger. And having done all the Christ demands to stand firmly in your place. Let's continue. We read that earlier. Let's go to the next one. Verse 14. Stand therefore, hold your ground, having tightened the belt of truth around your loins, and having put on the breastplate of integrity and of moral rectitude and right standing with God. Next verse, verse 15. And having shod your feet in preparation to face the enemy with the firm-footed stability, the promptness, and the readiness produced by the good news of the gospel of peace. Next. Lift up over all the covering shield of saving faith upon which you can quench all the flaming missiles of the wicked one. Let's have this verse, from Ephesians 6 verse 15, let's go back to the Amplified. Ephesians 6 verse 15, let's go back to the Amplified Bible. Ephesians 6 verse 15, it says, and having shod your feet in preparation to face the enemy with the firm-footed stability, the promptness, and the readiness produced by the good news of the gospel of peace. You see, of the gospel of peace. Hallelujah. This gospel is a gospel of peace. Having shown your feet in preparation for to face the enemy with the firm-footed stability, the promptness, and the readiness produced by the good news of the gospel of peace. So as you study God's word, what does it do? Every word that you're understanding, it's imbibed in your spirit, gives you stability. Next verse. Ephesians 6, verse 6 says, lift up above all the covering shield of saving faith. Above all, lift up the covering shield of what? Of saving faith. Upon which you can quench all the flaming missiles of the wicked one. Hallelujah. Lift up above all the covering shield of faith. Bible is very clear. Romans 10 verse 17. Faith comes by hearing and hearing the word of God. So scripture is telling us, hang on. You need to have faith. You need to hear God's word so that you can have faith. So you can grow your faith. The only way you grow your faith is when you hear more of God's word. Understand it. And understand it, it means you do more things. You're able to do more. Faith is personal, yes. Grow your faith. As I'm teaching again, and I say, let's go back to the scripture in Ephesians 6, verse 16. Lift up above all the covering shield of saving faith upon which you can quench all the flaming missiles of the wicked one. You can use faith. It doesn't matter what the enemy brings your path. You quench it with what? With faith. Your faith in God. Very important. Next verse. Verse 17. And then it says, and take the helmet of salvation. And what? And the sword that the Spirit wields, Hallelujah. Which is the word of God. It says, take what? The sword of the Spirit. Which is the word of God. It says, take the helmet of salvation. And what? And the sword of that the Spirit wields. Which Spirit? The Holy Spirit inside you. What is the word? The word of God. Which word there? The Greek word translated word in Ephesians 6 verse 17 is rhema. So it says, hang on. Bring up the verse again. Hang on. It says, hang on. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword that the Spirit wields, which is the word of God. Which is what? The rhema. Which is the word of God on your lips. The rhema is the spoken word. It is the now word. It is the quickening word. So it doesn't matter what you are facing. You speak the rhema, Libroshka. You speak God's word. When the doctor says, this is the diagnosis, they come up with the diagnosis, says, you got 2 months to live. You are going to die. You say, I shall live and not die. Hallelujah. Because you know the Holy Spirit working in you, the eternal life that you have is the eternal life of God, which is a disease crushing life. Hallelujah. It's indestructible. Hallelujah. You declare, I shall live and not die. You have the rhema word, this spoken word. You can make it. You can make it. The word is inside you. You're able to stand your ground. How? Through the word, through the rhema, the spoken word. The spoken word is the sword of the Spirit. Where is that sword? Sword of the Spirit. It's the word of God on your mouth. That's why it matters what you speak. Focus on the word so that in the middle of challenges, the sword of the Spirit is the rhema of God. The sword of the Spirit, that which cuts up the enemy, is the word of God on your lips. So when you are praying, you pray rhema. You speak rhema. The content matters. The content of prayers matters. Speak rhema. In the challenge, you need to speak rhema. Because why? The rhema word, the spoken word, is the sword of the Spirit. It's the word of God on your lips. What words your lips? Oh, I'm finished. If you say I'm finished, you are finished. Oh, I'm going to die. You are going to die. Oh, I'm a failure. You become a failure. No. I reign in life. Hallelujah. I will make it. Hallelujah. There's a way of escape for me through all challenges. God is faithful. What? You are speaking the rhema word now. When they say, oh, the corona infections are increasing, when people are dying, say, I shall live and not die. Hallelujah. My spirit is receptive to corona. My body is receptive to corona. You speak rhema. They say, you are poor. No, I am rich. Hallelujah. Say, you are a failure. No, I am a success. Hallelujah. Christ lives in me. I am God's headquarters. Hallelujah. The Holy Spirit lives in me. I will make it. I am a success. The sword of the Spirit is the rhema, the spoken word on your lips. What are you talking? What are you talking? You know, some women, if you've got a problem with your husband and he hasn't come home, or he's got a small house, they'll pray, he has a girlfriend now. He's left me. He's going to stay with the girlfriend. I don't know what to do. No. Shut up. That's not rhema. That's killing yourself. You speak rhema. Say, hang on. I shall live and not die. Everything that he desires in a wife is in me. He's coming back now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. My God will never leave me. No, forsake me. In this time, my husband is coming back. Or maybe it's your wife that left you. In the name of Jesus, you declare, in this time, my wife is coming back. You speak rhema, the spoken words. You speak possibility, not impossibility. God makes a way of escape for you through all situations. Luke 21 verse 36. How? As you speak, as you pray, speak the right words. Our time is up for today. Let's just go to the next verse, and then we'll finish off for there for today. Hallelujah. Ephesians 6 verse 18. Paul says, pray at all times, on every occasion, in every season, in the Spirit, that's praying in tongues, with all manner of prayer and entreaty. To that end, keep alert and watch with strong purpose and perseverance, interceding in behalf of all the saints, God's consecrated people. So Paul is telling us, hang on, you speak the rhema, but don't just pray for yourself only. Pray for other saints. Don't have selfish prayers, always pray for you, me, myself, I. Pray for other saints. Focus on the word. Speak the right language. Speak the right words. The word of God inside you, as you speak it in challenges, is the rhema word, the now word. God loves you too much. We thank you all, fathers. We thank you all, men. Happy Father's Day to all of you. Feed your spirit with God's word. Encourage your sons to feed on God's word. Encourage others to feed on God's word. Encourage women to feed on God's word. Encourage everyone in your word to feed on God's word. So that in times of trouble, they can speak the rhema that is needed. That rhema, which is the sword of the Spirit that cuts off the wickedness of Satan. Thank you for joining us in the service today. Just in case you're not born again, you've never confessed Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior, I encourage you now to confess Jesus as the Lord and Savior so that you are born again, so that the gift of righteousness is imparted to your spirit, so that it comes to live inside you and you can start your walk in the Lord and grow in faith and reign over all of life's circumstances. Just repeat these words after me. Say, from today, Jesus is the Lord of my life. He died on the cross, was buried, and resurrected. But he lives in me by the power of the Holy Spirit. With those words, my brothers and sisters, you are born again. You are a child of God now. There are contacts on your screens. We'd love to hear from you. Let us hear from you. And we'd love to send some information and help you in your walk, help you to grow in the Lord. Our contacts are on your screens right now. We encourage you to get in touch with us. And if you're already born again, we'd also love to hear from you how you've been blessed in this service. Please get in touch with us on the same contacts on your screens right now. And we thank you so much. And at this moment, I'll encourage you to give. Hallelujah. To give your offerings as well, to give your tithes and offerings as well, to give your seeds as well, to give your offerings. You should always give offering in every service. Hallelujah. It is the godly thing to do. Our church banking details are on your screens right now. You are able to give your offerings and your seeds and tithes by electronic file transfer using the bank details on your screens right now. You can also give directly online right now. Use the online link on your screens right now. I'd encourage you to go ahead and give your offering without delay. Give without delay. Hallelujah. Do what the Lord is telling you to do right now. I thank you all for those of you that are sowing financially in this ministry and partnering with us. Thank you so much. God bless you. You are helping to take this gospel to the ends of the earth. I declare that every expectation that you have with your seed, results are guaranteed. I declare in Jesus' name that you shall prosper and God will increase the grace at work in you. And this is a special time for you. 2020 is our year of perfection. There's completion taking place. There's alignment with God's will taking place. There's fruition taking place. There's excellence taking place. This will be the best year of your life yet. Thank you so much. God bless you. I also want to encourage you to watch today, every Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, 6:30 to 6:40 p.m. That is GMT plus 2, that's Johannesburg, South Africa time. For 10 minutes only, we have a live broadcast of Boards of Wisdom. You'll be mightily blessed. We are currently doing the series titled Game Changers, and in this portion of Game Changers, we're dealing with gender-based violence. You'll be mightily, mightily blessed. Hallelujah. And connect with you. You'll be glad you did. Hallelujah. And I also encourage you to join us on Wednesday, for our midweek Wednesday service, which is from 6:30 p.m. to 7:15 p.m. That is GMT plus 2, Johannesburg, South Africa time. You'll be mightily, mightily, mightily blessed. We start a new series this coming Wednesday. We just finished a series called Holy Disruptors. What a series we had. And I encourage you again, go onto our YouTube channel. All these messages are on there. And you can subscribe on our YouTube channel and watch these messages, share links with others. And on Facebook, go ahead, create watch parties with other people long after you finish preaching and teaching. Create watch parties. God bless you. 2020 is the best year yet of your life. We are enjoying ourselves. God is faithful. Hallelujah. And in June, it's a special month for the youth in South Africa. June 16th was an official holiday for the official youth day. Youth, you are awesome. Your future is secure. You are going to shine more than ever before. God is faithful. Your future is secure in Christ. Thank you all for joining us. And at this moment, I encourage you, let us share the grace. It's ready to close today's meeting. Let's share the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide in us now and forevermore. In Jesus' name, amen. And surely, goodness and mercy are our portion all the days of our lives as we dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. In Jesus' name. Amen. You're a good, good father. It's
Wow, today is Father's Day. Oh, what a privilege and an honor to have you, Pastor Andrew, as our Father. You are indeed our great shepherd with a shepherd's heart, an effective leader, a guide, a protector and provider. Thank you for the rhema we receive every day and for your prayers for us.
Blessed Happy Father's Day, Pastor Andrew said. Thank you so much for being such a great example of fatherhood. The love and the care that you share for all to all Oasis brethren, it is so inspiring, Pastor. We have learned so much from you, and thank you. You daily feed us with the word of God. Pastor, we thank you and we really appreciate you.
A blessed and glorious Father's Day to you, Pastor Anderson. Thank you for being a godly leader. Thank you for teaching me to walk by the word of God and to take the love of God to everyone, everywhere. Have a fabulous day, sir.
Happy Father's Day, Pastor Andrew Mtondoro. We thank God for you. You have been there for us from the beginning, ever since I joined the ministry, in good and even in difficult times. Thank you for being a father figure, even to my family, being a father figure, even to me. Thank you for your counsel. Thank you for the word and for the encouragement. Thank you so much for being a pillar, for being there when we call you, even at odd times. We love you. We cherish you. May God continue to bless you and give you the insight as to how to move the ministry forward. We love you and we continue to cherish you. Enjoy your day. Happy Father's Day.
Pastor Andrew, my great man of God, a prophet of our time, a man who can take somebody from the mere clay to be somebody who can sit in the boardroom, to be somebody who can talk among many people. I could not talk myself, but Pastor Andrew made it possible. Happy Father's Day, sir.
Happy Father's Day to you, Pastor Andrew, sir. I want to say thank you so much for being my father. Thank you so much for being my life coach. Thank you so much for being my teacher. And I'm so grateful that I'm a child of Oasis Christian Assembly. I'm so grateful that I'm a child of Pastor Andrew. Thank you for making me global solution provider. Happy Father's Day.
The role of a father is mentioned in Ephesians 6 verse 4, is to bring up children in the ways of the Lord. Thank you, Pastor Andrew, for being a faithful father to us.
And for raising us up in the way of the Lord. We love you, sir. May the Lord continue increasing the fathering grace upon your life.
Happy Father's Day, Pastor Andrew.
Thank you, Pastor Andrew, for your love for me. Thank you, Pastor Andrew, for your love for my family. Because of your teachings, I am a success. Because of your teachings, I am who I am. Happy Father's Day, my pastor.
You changed our lives, oh. You gave it a meaning.
Happy Father's Day, Pastor Andrew.
We love you.
Thank you, Pastor Andrew, for being such a man of love, of liquid love. Utando, thank you for raising us to be who we are today, and under your wings we are flourishing.
Pastor, thank you for being the best teacher, not just the teacher of the word of God, but the teacher of life. I have not only just been taught to be a good person and a successful person, I have also become a teacher of many good and successful men and women. Thank you, Pastor.
Thank you, Pastor Andrew, for your liquid love for me and my family. Thank you for making me an SSF game changer. Happy Father's Day.
Happy, happy Father's Day. Happy, happy Father's Day. Happy, happy Father's Day. Happy, happy Father's Day. Happy Father's Day, Pastor Andrew. We love you, a man of faith, great daddy. I love you.
And I love you.
Happy, 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 supernatural and glorious Father's Day to you, Pastor Seth. Thank you for being a great father. Thank you for preaching the word that transforms our lives. We love you dearly. May you have an absolute amazing day as we celebrate you. We love you dearly, Pastor Seth. Thank you.
Happy Father's Day, Pastor Andrew. Father to the fatherless. What manner of love that you have for us. There's no one like you, sir. My life is an expression of your love. Thank you for making me what I ought to be. Thank you, sir. I love you and greatly appreciate you beyond words.
Pastor Say, happy Father's Day. We love you so much. Thank you for making us who we are. Thank you for raising us in the Word of God. We love you, Pastor. Yay!
Happy Father's Day, my father, my mentor, my prophet, my leader, my trailblazer. Thank you for teaching me that masculinity protects women. Masculinity creates opportunities for women. Happy Father's Day!
My heart is full of memories of all good things that you've done for me. Today is a special day that I would like to congratulate you, Pastor Say. Happy Father's Day, Pastor Andrew Utondoro. I love you dearly, Pastor. May God increase you in wisdom and understanding in everything about your life. God bless you, Say. Thank you.
Happy Father's Day, Pastor Andrew. I love and appreciate you. Thank you for teaching us the Word of God and showing us how to be fathers that are full of the Holy Spirit. We learn a lot from you, sir. You're indeed a father that is exemplary, the tupos, the one that teaches us the Word of God every day. And you are a true example of what a father is. We thank you, sir, for your dedication to the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you, sir.